I'm Sabine O'Hara, Dean of the University of the District of Columbia's College of Agriculture, Urban Sustainability and Environmental Sciences, and host of a television series we have entitled Causes. The cause driving this television series is you, the residents of the District of Columbia. The College of Agriculture, Urban Sustainability and Environmental Sciences, or CAUSES, is dedicated to improving the quality of life and economic opportunity for the people and communities of the District of Columbia, and by extension, the quality of life for people across the nation and the world. We pursue our mission through our academic programs in nutrition, dietetics, nursing, health education, architecture, and environmental science, and through our research-based community outreach programs that serve thousands of residents in every ward of the district through our 5 land grant centers in nutrition, dietetics, and health, sustainable development, urban agriculture, architectural research, and youth development. The topic of discussion on this program is one that couldn't be more relevant to your quality of life in the District of Columbia: water. Without clean, fresh water, there is no quality of life. In fact, without water, there is no life at all. Our bodies are made up primarily of water, and so is our planet. My guests are experts on water, its qualities, and its many uses. Dr. Mark Dunning is president-elect of the American Water Resources Association, AWRA, a national association dedicated to multidisciplinary approaches to water resources management, water education, and water research. Dr. Dunning's career took him to the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers and to the private sector, including his current position in water resources planning with CDM Smith in Fairfax, Virginia. Dr. Tolessa Deksissa is the director of the Water Resources Research Institute in the Causes Center for Sustainable Development right here at the University of the District of Columbia. Welcome, Dr. Dunning and Dr. Deksissa.
Pleasure to be here.
Water, that is one big topic. Tell us a little bit, Dr. Dunning, what is your association all about? Is it just about research and science on water, or is it broader than that, the uses of water and so forth?
Well, Dean O'Hara, we basically came into being almost 50 years ago. Next year is our 50th anniversary as the AWRA, and basically, we are focused on the practice of water resources management, mm-hmm. and the multidisciplinary nature of water. Water is a very complex subject and has lots of different aspects to it. It has legal aspects, engineering aspects, social science aspects, economics, mm-hmm. and in order to really tackle most of the issues that water management faces, you need that multidisciplinary approach. So over the years, AWRA's culture has evolved to be very strong on 3 themes. We call it community, conversations, and connections. We've developed a very strong community that values interdisciplinary research and best management practices, and we've created a culture that really values the conversations that take place among disciplines to really communicate with one another and develop a better understanding among what various disciplines have to offer. And finally, we provide the connections, the connectivity among the disciplines, such that people can learn how to really interact with other disciplines and build a more robust water management career.
Mm-hmm. So much more than water quality itself, right? It's a much broader topic. And it seems to me, Dr. Deksissa, you also head up here at UDC our professional science masters in water resources management, and that too is a very interdisciplinary approach that you take in that program. So tell us a little bit about what kind of fields are represented in that professional science master's program.
Yeah, thank you. As Dr. Denny said, water is multidisciplinary. So it needs more than just one discipline to solve the problem of water. So the professional science master is designed for that kind of problem, where you need both professional skills like project management, communication, ethics, professional ethics. Mm-hmm. Those soft skills has never been part of the water resource engineering courses. Mm-hmm. This is a great part of the program that really prepare our students for the current age to make them be multi-task, yeah, in addition to just hard technical hydro science courses. Mm-hmm.
So we do need the sciences, right? But you both know I'm a little bit partial. Mm-hmm. I'm a social scientist myself, right, as an environmental economist, so I couldn't agree more. It takes more than the sciences. And that can be a bit of a challenge too, right, to sort of get our heads around all these different aspects. It seems to me too that water is becoming more and more important, isn't it? Both as a resource that's becoming increasingly scarce in some places, but also sometimes overabundant. And we have that very problem right here in the district, right? Because when we have big storm events, some of our neighborhoods are experiencing an overabundance of water, and yet at the same time, you know, we're looking ahead to summer and probably the next water shortage. Is that a pattern that you see all over the place, or is it just sort of a regional occurrence here in the district?
I think it tends to be a common problem all over. It's either too scarce or too much in abundance, as you say. Of course, in the Great Plains right now, the nation is experiencing a very severe drought. And yes. I was just reading the other day that they were saying that perhaps this large snowfall may that they are experiencing in the plains may take some of the a top off of that drought, but it's a very severe problem. And then other places, what we've experienced with Superstorm Sandy in the Northeast, too much rain, too much wind, too much storm surge, very severe mm-hmm. issue. Mm-hmm.
Is it particularly exacerbated in a place like DC and other places, I would say, on the East Coast that are a little bit older than the rest of the country? So is that kind of problem exacerbated in an area where you have older infrastructure?
Certainly old infrastructure is a big problem. And on a more national scale, trying to obtain the resources address an aging infrastructure, called recapitalize the aging infrastructure is a big problem.
Mm-hmm. So how do we manage water, Dr. Deksissa? What are some of the tools we use?
Yeah, thank you. Actually, that is the main focus now. In the 21st century, the water resource management has to actually deal with this little water. We don't have enough water, so we have to think about how we can make water available for everybody. And the other one is how to manage this extreme event, like too much water. So when you have aging infrastructure, this is the sewer system especially, which mm-hmm. is very difficult and expensive. So when it's aging, you will have so much, when it is heavy rain, you will face sewer backup in your basement, and also combined sewer overflow, and this untreated sewage goes into the river. For example, in DC area, Rock Creek, and Anacostia, and the Potomac. Unless we address this issue, we can no way make the Anacostia and the Rock Creek swimmable and fishable.
Yeah.
So how do you address it? And there is currently a lot of best management practice and this low impact development project is going on. So the mission of the Water Resource Research Institute right now is helping or supporting the water project of the district supporting both in research, training, and education component by training young scientists, and also by collaborating, facilitating the expertise, you know, water research expertise in the consortium to contribute this solution to address the issue of this water resource management in the district. Mm-hmm. That's where we are focusing right now.
So right here in the district, of course, this topic of water resources management and how do you balance the not enough and too much, plus the whole quality issues. You said, you know, one of the ambitions would be for our local rivers to be actually swimmable and fishable, which we all know right now they're not, right? And especially the Anacostia, we seem to be quite a ways away from a fishable and swimmable river. So that is also a big topic in Mayor Vincent Gray's Sustainable DC plan that was just recently unveiled. So what are some of the themes there? What are some of the projects, what are some of the strategies that we're pursuing here in the district to address these water management problems?
Well, I can't necessarily speak exactly to the district, but I know that AWRA is very much behind a best management practice for water management called Integrated Water Resources Management, and our IWRM. And we believe that this is the way to bring the diverse elements of problems together, the diverse stakeholders that need to be problem solving around water issues in a constructive, collaborative way. So we have been gathering information on IWRM around the country and have recently published a case study book on where it is being applied and what the lessons learned are. And we're sponsoring a conference on IWRM next summer. And we believe that by publishing lessons learned and gathering more information on it, that we can benefit programs like UDC's and others to provide students and practitioners with those best management practices.
So from the information that you've already gathered, are there any success stories that particularly stand out?
Yes. I should also mention that we are sponsoring prize or an award for IWRM. Uh-huh. And we awarded it the first time last year to a River Basin Association in the West, in Oregon. Mm-hmm. Where they were faced with water quantity, water quality issues, and they successfully, through a collaborative effort, worked through those kinds of issues and developed a water management plan for the basin that you know, all the stakeholders bought into, the farmers, the city folks, and the various other users of the water, which is not an easy thing to do.
Not an easy thing to do, right? A lot of conflicting interests. But it sounds like that part of the management approach that you describe really moves quite a bit beyond what we would normally sort of look at as the experts, right? The scientists, the hydrologists, and so forth, to really include residents and participants in that.
you need your experts, you need the technical information, but you need to get the input from the stakeholders mm-hmm. about their preferences and about their constraints, and somehow mix that all together in a productive problem-solving way.
Mm-hmm. What are some of the projects we're engaged here right now?
Yeah, WRRI, or with the Resource Research Institute, actually supporting those or encouraging those kind of research that actually promote this best management practice, testing the effectiveness of this green roof mm-hmm. project right now in the district, and how you know monitor what is the limitation and so on. This is what lacking. There is not much information out there. So supporting those research can help us to know what's working, what's not working before we invest mm-hmm. a lot of money mm-hmm. on this kind mm-hmm. of project.
Mm-hmm. Tell us a little bit. That's really an interesting issue to me, because it sounds like a big part of water management here in the district is to reduce some of the storm water flow, right? Mm-hmm. Because we have an aging infrastructure, so there is too much water that goes mm-hmm. into our sewers when we have, particularly when we have mm-hmm. heavy rainfalls. So what could people actually do? I mean, what can people do in their own backyards, some of the residential spaces that we have? Give us some examples.
Everybody contribute to this. If you look at how much water you use, mm-hmm. that is amount of volume of water that goes to that pipe. But one pipe that collect both your household wastewater, and plus in the combined sewer overflow area, it also collects the storm water. So the less the water you use, the better it is for the pipe to accommodate what you are putting into mm-hmm. the pipe. Mm-hmm. And also reusing some water and also disconnect your, the roof rain coming from the gutter. So if you disconnect that also, doesn't go into the sewer, overwhelming the sewer mm-hmm. system. This is as part of the district government project, like River Smart is a good example right now in addressing this issue as well. Use water and small, reduce the use of water and reduce the pervious layer. Like if you change your driveway into like pervious layer, like mm-hmm. use bricks or gravels if possible, mm-hmm. you can reduce the amount of runoff to the pipe. And this is just an example. Mm-hmm. And anything that you do to reduce the amount of runoff from your area can contribute to the solution of this.
So reducing both the use of water at the front end, because then there is less that goes into the pipes, but also thinking of other ways to reduce what goes mm-hmm. into the system. Mm-hmm. See, I'm already doing that. I already have gravel on my driveway. So if more people in the district did that, we would reduce some of the load, right? Yeah. What is the connection between roofs and water management? That seems sort of like a little bit of a stretch.
Well, it's another aspect of impervious surfaces and runoff that has to go somewhere. Mm-hmm. Now, in some areas and in the past, they would create cisterns off of the runoff from the roof and conserve the water. And I know that some places offer rain barrels to do that, so that you can buy the rain barrel and connect your gutter system up to that and kind of stockpile your water for mm-hmm. for use in various ways.
Mm-hmm. So, you know, it seems to me that we're getting back to some of the management practices that are really quite old-fashioned, right?
Because that's right.
I mean, when I remember, we had a rain barrel in our backyard when I was growing up, and we would then dip our watering cans into it, right, mm-hmm. to water the flower beds or the vegetable beds or so forth. Are these some of the practices we're getting back to?
Sometimes the old ways are the good ways.
Yes, so. Yes. So sometimes that's recovering what we once knew, right? What are some newer strategies, newer management strategies? You know, you mentioned both the need to monitor, but also to model.
Yep, actually to check, you know, what we do actually working or not, you need to have tools. Not one tools, you need more than one tool. So the for water resource management, if you integrate both the measurement, if you just use a lab, or if you measure quantified, and also if you have a predictive tool. So the predictive tool gives you an idea how much you can do mm-hmm. and what you can change. Mm-hmm. Based on that, you can design your research and then check that and then implement it if that's successful. Mm-hmm. So the monitoring is the most important part, which is expensive, but you need it anyway. Especially when you do a green roof, some water quality variable can increase, mm-hmm. some decrease. You have to understand how you're gonna even remove the one which increases. So if you don't measure, you don't know. Yeah. You try to solve one problem, then you exacerbate the other one. Mm-hmm. So the monitoring is the most powerful part of the water resource mm-hmm. management. And we have now a very cutting edge research lab right now that can support both the research activity plus the academic program. Right now we are, based on that lab, we established our master program, two master programs actually established now at UDC. One is professional science master in water resource management, this is third year, and the civil engineering master program also now on the way. The other is we also developed some courses in water area for undergraduate course. So this is all tied to the lab, mm-hmm. and we are preparing the young scientists for that. And this is a great contribution for the district.
Yes,
as a land grant institute.
Right, and if there's any message, probably water will become more important rather than less important, right? So in terms of the jobs of the future, certainly water is an important area to focus on. Mm-hmm. Dr. Dunning, you mentioned a water conference, a water symposium. Say a little bit more about that. What are the plans for that?
Okay, sure. Yes, we're very pleased that we are having our first day-long water symposium here in the district with UDC being a co-sponsor of that. It's going to be held here at UDC in early April. And basically, it's a focus on past, present, and future water resources, challenges, and practices in the district, primarily a district focus. We have the morning is devoted to some keynote addresses and panels that kind of take the big picture. The afternoon is devoted to some concurrent sessions where there'll be technical papers delivered on some of the topics that were mentioned here, technical aspects of water resources management. But we have, as our keynote speaker, John Winterston, who is a professor of history, who's speaking about, he wrote a book on the Anacostia River called mm-hmm. The Life and Death of an American River. Mm-hmm. So you can imagine perhaps what he's going to be focused on in his remarks. And we have a panel on flood damage prevention. As a coastal city, the district has some fairly severe flood problems mm-hmm. from time to time, and so a panel will be talking about some of those aspects. And then I think in the National Capital Region, Virginia, Maryland, and the district, we're very fortunate to have an agency called the Interstate Commission on the Potomac River Basin, mm-hmm. which sort of coordinates and encourages collaboration among the four states and the district that comprise the Potomac River Basin. And the director of the ICPRB will be offering his perspectives on the past of water management and the future of water management in the Potomac Basin, particularly in the district. So it should be a very exciting and worthwhile event.
And sounds like a series of very broad topics. So are you looking for participants in the symposiums both from the scientific and the sort of planning side, but also residents open to the public that is interested?
Absolutely.
Absolutely, okay. So it's going to be a very exciting conversation about that broad topic of water. Three bodies of water that are really, really relevant, close to home, you might say, right? The Potomac, the Anacostia, and the Rock Creek. Mm-hmm. Which one has the biggest problems?
Yeah.
Depends, I guess.
whatever the combined sewer overflow, there is a problem.
Yeah.
So you just follow that. I think all have some combined sewer overflow. So
stay tuned for the conference. So my guests today were Dr. Mark Dunning, president-elect of the National
American Water Resources Association,
thank you, and Dr. Tolessa Deksissa, director of the Water Resources Research Institute in the Causes Center for Sustainable Development here at UDC. I'd like to thank both of you for sharing your experience and your expertise with our viewers. And I thank you, our viewers, for joining me for Causes, a television series from the College of Agriculture, Urban Sustainability, and Environmental Sciences of the University of the District of Columbia. We are dedicated to improving the quality of life and economic opportunity for people and communities in the District of Columbia. If you would like more information, please visit us at www.causes.edu. I am Sabine O'Hara. See you next time on Causes.